Just remind me which film it is.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
Well, I'm actually wondering now, since you're not actually Morgan Spurlock. But see, it's funny. Like, I respect Morgan for what he does.
Yeah.
But what you do is much more serious as a role. And yet you're putting...
I'm trying to break out into comedy. I'm trying so hard. And I failed again.
But you're making as much product, if not more product, than he is. It's kind of crazy. How do you do all this? Do you have a factory going? Or
look, we got a great number of teams of people. And that's how it works. Also, it's funny the way some of these investigative films work, which is they don't often resolve themselves on a schedule, particularly if you're trying to get certain people to talk.
Right.
So you kind of, in order to be able to make a living at it, you kind of have to do things in tandem. But, you know, over time, to my, you know, probably to my great regret, I've learned how to, you know, sort of do a couple of things simultaneously. It's very difficult to shoot two or three things simultaneously,
right.
But to cut two or three things simultaneously is not that impossible. Particularly if you have extraordinary editors like I do. I mean, you know, you make sure you get yourself in business with great researchers, great DPs, and great editors.
It's almost like you've set up 60 minutes in your own place. Where they're just constantly working on stories.
Right.
And
so some people would laugh if you said 60 minutes. Usually mine are closer to 120.
Yes.
Yeah.
But it does have that feel to it. I mean, that you've now branched into sports.
So I love that.
Two or three sports
documentaries. I'm a sports freak. So I love that. And I've done a bunch of music stuff. And we're going to continue on that too, because that is so refreshing for me, you know, so that you're not always doing...
Mm-hmm.
Human life is more than misery and abuse of power. I mean, it's a lot of what it is. but there is, thankfully, music and sports to take our minds off the misery.
So is the job of directing the same as it was 5 years ago when you were doing one at a time? Or
Yeah. It's not that different. I mean, I think, you know, the truth is too that when you get a little older, you do get a little wiser. You know, you may not be able to party all night as aggressively as you used to be able to do in the past, but you can be smarter about how to see films and what not to do and what paths not to go down.
Mm-hmm.
You see stories a little bit more easily. So. And interestingly enough, the more films you do, the more films you're able to make, because you begin to see patterns.
Right.
So practice doesn't make perfect, but it makes better.
Do you think you'll have like a film in the next 3 years that's still sitting there on the shelf that you can't quite finish?
Well, look, I'm having this problem now. I mean, the Lance Armstrong film has been beset.
Yeah.
And to some extent overtaken by events, but we're trying now to be able to move forward and finish that one. So, and sometimes, you know, that happens. There was a film I had up here last year that was beset by legal problems, and now I guess it's finally coming out this October.
In time for what happens in October for hockey? Is it the hockey movie?
Yeah, The Last Gladiators. I don't know what happens. I mean, I think
so
the
it's
hockey
not
season
set to the
starts.
Hockey season. It's the beginning of the hockey season?
Yeah, I think so.
That makes some sense. So the Lance Armstrong thing you were doing with him or next to him?
I mean, we followed Lance for the 2009 year when he was making his comeback.
Right.
And the year he came in third in the Tour de France. So throughout that year, I followed him.
So he was cooperative?
He was cooperative, yeah. And we got a lot of cooperation from a lot of people who've since been named as co-conspirators in this.
So you kind of have to do that story on some level.
Yeah, I think, I mean, it's up to us to finish it. And I think in a way, hopefully, I reckon with kind of the shades of gray in this story. We'll see.
Do you think Lance will cooperate?
We're hoping. Never hurts to ask.
Yeah, that's true. So you have this film here this year, Maxima Mea Culpa.
Mea Maxima Culpa.
Mea Maxima Culpa. See, I'm already...
Here's how you know, because in the Catholic Church, used to, during the confiteor, the confession part of the church, you would hit your breast three times. You'd say, mea culpa. We all know mea culpa.
Mm-hmm.
Mea culpa, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa.
Ah.
Through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault, is how they used to translate it.
say as a Jew, we just say oi.
Oi, right.
Oi.
Yeah. Exactly.
So this title will not be unfamiliar to Catholics.
Catholics are always much wordier. Yeah. I have a good Catholic Jewish joke, which I can tell later.
Okay.
It's about the Pope.
Oh, is it? It's good to have a Pope joke.
Yes.
But so Catholics will actually recognize this title.
Yes.
It's not going to be a...
Particularly if you're an older Catholic. After, you know, Vatican II, a lot of that Latin disappeared. But it's an integral part of the Latin Mass.
So what got you started? What was the first spark that got you down this road?
I saw a piece in the New York Times, cover story about this abuse case in Milwaukee, mm-hmm. and how it was connected to the Vatican, and how indeed the Vatican... You could see through this case how the Vatican aided and abetted and possibly actively covered up child sexual abuse.
Was there enough there? There was enough there to start, or did you feel like there was enough there that you kind of already could start thinking about an arc?
I think there was enough there so you could already start thinking about an arc. But it's one thing to think about an arc. It's another thing to know that there are people or images enough to be able to tell that story. Because mm-hmm. that's the advantages, of course, that print journalists have. They can embellish, they can guide, and they can create out of, you know, disparate comments and telling, you know, verbal details a story. But if you're a filmmaker, you have to have people who talk. You have to have images that show you something. And so the question was, would we have those?
And ultimately that kind of was lynched around the guys, the three deaf guys who speak quite eloquently through the film?
That's right. You know, it's a story, it's a crime story, really. And it's a crime
story. The music,
story.
You said that in the Q&A afterwards. I went, the music is definitely a crime story. That's
right.
Like,
well, we asked for that. We said, you know, put on your Hitchcock hat and please give us that. I mean, he was also very good, I think, the composer, getting liturgical music into the mix. Mm-hmm. But there's definitely a kind of thriller vibe, and that was by intent. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, we said, listen to... what's his name? Bernard Herrmann. You know, go listen to some Bernard Herrmann, and you know, take us there.
Well, you know, it's funny because you, we're sitting here shooting like this, and you can see how brilliant this image is going to be when it comes out. But the way you shoot the three deaf men who tell their stories is kind of spectacular. I mean, visually, you get something out of them. It's almost like an art piece to look at them sign. And they express themselves the way they do. Did you have to consider shooting them in a way that you don't normally shoot interview yep. subjects?
Yeah, I mean, we did a massive test, actually, with all sorts of different approaches, different kind mm-hmm. of light, different kind of approaches, and we really, you know, tried to work out a scheme because I felt these people were going to be on camera talking mm-hmm. a lot, but they weren't going to be saying anything. They were going to be signing. So how could we shoot them in a way that would convey the richness of that language and that expression? Mm-hmm. And so we had a very complicated setup, actually. It was four cameras, one from the side, one head-on, one just off angle, and then another one picking up some detail. And then we had a very complicated sound setup, actually, which seems odd for guys who don't speak, mm-hmm. but I wanted people to hear the clapping when they move their hands and the grunts when they're talking, or sometimes when they, you know, the certain sounds that they make that are not necessarily words. I wanted people mm-hmm. to hear that. So we put a teleprompter in front of the camera lens, which was piped into another room where there was a interpreter, and then I was in that other room talking to the interpreter, and the interpreter would sign the questions to the subject. The subject would then see it on the prompter mm-hmm. and then would respond in kind, so that then everything was silent in the room in which we were shooting. Mm-hmm. And that was very valuable. And even when we do voiceover over other images, we continue on sometimes with those sounds. That
mm-hmm. Well, you actually almost get like fresco-like images of their faces.
Mm-hmm. Just well, their faces
beautiful.
Are very expressive. We also reduce the depth of field. So you're focusing on a very narrow plane. And we did something interesting with the hands. We shot with a variable shutter. sort of like what Spielberg did in Saving Private Ryan, but for a very different purpose. Mm-hmm. And that way you kind of see a flutter of the hands. You notice the hands more in a way that you would normally do.
It's really extraordinary, because I felt like I was hearing them as much as I was watching them.
Right.
While doing it, it was quite something. And even actually in the footage you guys had from the guy who had a handy cam or whatever, a video camera of some kind shooting when they went to
see Father Murphy, right.
And you hear the woman who was there before you see her.
Right.
And you're kind of wondering what that sound is, but you know it's a human sound, you just don't know who it's coming from or whether that's his pitch or whether it's her pitch. It's kind of a fascinating, as somebody who is not around deaf people very often, it was a very interesting way of
this kind of a bird-like
world.
Squeak and an attempt to communicate, but you can't hear to modulate your sound, so it comes out in ways that are unpredictable and you can't control.
You were kind enough in your Q&A to mention Deliver Us From Evil having an interview with a pedophile priest.
Sure.
And your choice not to do that. Can you expand on that a little bit? I think in some ways having that pedophile priest that became the, even though Deliver Us From Evil was not only about him, it kind of the weight of the movie and how people say, well, what's that movie? Oh, it's the movie with the pedophile priest. The weight goes to that because it's such an unusual thing to see. But what was your choice in terms of that?
Well, look, my choice was to follow the story. I mean, trust me, if Father Murphy had been alive, I would have done everything I could to talk to him. So it wasn't like I was resisting the idea.
Right.
It just wasn't available to me. Father Murphy was dead.
Ratzinger wasn't coming to it.
Pope Benedict was not answering any of my calls or letters. So that's really the reason. And, you know, the key thing about this story was being able to, one of the things that I liked about this story was that it had a direct connection to the Pope. So it enabled me to follow that chain. You got to deal with the story that's before you and find the best way to tell it as you can manage.
Did you feel any pressure coming from the church yourself?
Not really. I mean, we did, you know, we approached them any number of times, but we didn't go out and forcefully announce the film. Mm-hmm. And indeed, I started out thinking I would make a much more, you know, I started out hoping that I would be able to engage the church and they would be able to talk to me about how they wanted to move forward and so forth and so on. But, you know, there's a reason at the end of the day why silence in the house of God has so many different meanings mm-hmm. for this film. And one of them was the utter silence with which the church expressed its, interaction with us.
Well, you keep on thinking that them talking would be the beginning of actually just letting it go. It's almost like until they speak out loud about it.
They don't want to be held to. They don't want to be held to account. I find it interesting that a church that's so much about charity and love, so much about Christ's, gift, mm-hmm. is that they're so consumed with power. They would never deign to do that because it would diminish their power. Well, what does it matter? Their power on earth, yeah. But it turns out it matters a lot.
Well, it's the insular nature of, everything. I'm not sure obviously this is a horrible situation and specific to the church, and of course there are other things the church has done over the years that are a little questionable, but it seems like every organization folds in on itself.
Yeah, and every organization defends itself, and every organization comes up with rationalizations for why it needs to protect its reputation rather than to ferret out crime and do the right thing for people who may be victimized. Penn State is a classic example. I mean, Penn State is the Vatican writ small.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's the same impulse. It's like, okay, you know, screwed a few kids in the shower, but we don't want that to rub off on Joe Paterno and the great, you know, football teams of the past.
When the rage that was expressed when it was made public.
Well, the rage that at the victims, correct.
Yeah.
And very often, you know, even in Milwaukee, when these kids started to come forward, and they were by then out of college, but they were young men, when they started to come forward, there was a rage toward them in the deaf community in Milwaukee because they felt that Father Murphy had raised a ton of dough for the Catholic Church. And as a result, you know, why were they trying to kill the golden goose. This was a guy who had given so much, who had made so much out of St. John's and educated so many deaf kids, and now you're trying to ruin everything by coming up with these charges just because you were molested a few times?
Yeah.
It teaches you a weird lesson. I mean, you know, people can't seem... It seems difficult for people, for all of us. I won't say it's difficult for me too, but to hold two things in balance, to look at somebody and realize that they're a nice guy and they pet their dog and they may do wonderful things, but they may also do horrible things. And just because they do wonderful things, it doesn't mean that we can ignore the horrible things. Or if we convict them ultimately of the horrible things, it doesn't mean that there isn't part of them that's very good.
Yeah.
So this idea of good guys and bad guys is so fundamentally malicious. You know, there's something in the film that somebody says, Archbishop Weakland, a very flawed character, the guy who was popped for taking $450,000 out of the church coffers in order to settle his own sex scandal.
Mm-hmm.
But he says something very interesting at the end of the film. He said, you know, maybe we should just take the pedestal away from the Pope and the cardinals and the priests and all of that until we get down to our essential humanity. And he says, Christ wasn't afraid of humanity, and neither should we be. So that says something about the idea that we're all deeply flawed. If we recognize that, then it's not so hard for institutions to hold people to account without feeling that the institution itself is challenged. Because indeed, what institutions ultimately discover, like Penn State has discovered, if you, and like the Catholic Church is beginning to discover,
mm-hmm.
if you insist on perfection and then people discover you're not perfect, there's a price to be paid.
Though if you start taking the pedestals away, then you often do, I think the institutions actually are threatened, because it's hard to maintain an institution that's based on fear and faith and those things without and not feel like there's something bigger besides God, I guess, that you have to hang on to. I mean, I think as soon as you make everybody equal, people have a tendency to start losing faith in the institution. So even though I don't agree with the choice of doing it, it seems, I think it's a real threat.
But wouldn't it be great to have an institution that's self-regarding enough to understand that there are people inside that institution who do bad things, and if they discover them, they'll root them out, because that way they're protecting victims and thereby living up to the ideals of the institution. I mean, that's the fundamental
yes.
problem with the Catholic Church, is it isn't living up to its own professed ideals. You know, it's blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Well, I'm sorry, but in this case, the meek were grievously abused, and not only were they abused, but once the church knew about that abuse, they covered it up.
Well, but see, I think we even see it in something as less horrifying, like Barack Obama, where, you know, there was a campaign, now that he's being held to account for not changing the entire world in 3 years.
Sure.
And at the same time, not just by the right, but by the left too.
Sure.
People on the left who are disappointed by not having this magical moment are now, you know, bitching about the fact that he only did more than any other president they've had in a long time. You know, since FDR, really. I don't think any president has done as much with that mandate as Barack Obama has in 3 years, and yet somehow that's not enough. And we should be disappointed, and we should, you know, question him.
Well, I'm one of those people who is disappointed, and I'm not sure he's done quite as much as you say, but he has made some real accomplishments. But I do think that the point that maybe we can both agree on is that it was unreasonable to expect him to be the Messiah.
Yes.
Barack Obama was a flawed political figure coming into office.
Mm-hmm.
And he talked a great game, but ultimately his instincts were those of a politician, not of an idealist. So, mm-hmm. and I think his great flaw, perhaps, was that he wasn't as experienced as he might have been.
Yes.
To be able to understand how brutal the political battle was going to be.
Which suggests to me that he is an idealist. See, that my argument would be the other side of that.
I think he was just inexperienced, frankly. I think that he felt that people would compromise, and that he had an opportunity to compromise with people. I think sometimes, you know, what George Bush should have taught us all is that you ask for more than you think you're going to get,
right.
and you settle for what you want.
That's true, but then I guess he'd be everything the Republicans say he is. Of course, it wouldn't matter, but...
No, I just feel that, you know, he had a moment where there was a kind of popular rage against a financial system that was reckless and inhumane and cruel. And he had an opportunity to rail against that system and to change it. And he didn't take that opportunity.
Well, the question I wonder whether he actually, how much he could have changed it, really. I mean, your last film was, or not your last film, but a couple of films ago, a couple of years at Toronto, I mean, is a great film about this. And, you know, it is frustrating to watch that movie, and you do take on Barack Obama as much as you take on the right-wing people. And it's fascinating, and I think it's truthful.
Oh, you're talking about Inside Job.
Inside Job.
Yeah, but I didn't do that.
Oh, God, I'm on the wrong guy. Charles, again.
Charles Ferguson.
Ferguson
did a film called Client 9.
You were doing Client 9 that year. Oh, God, how embarrassing for me. Oh, well. You would have done
helped
it.
Charles
you made
Ferguson,
Charles happen.
I helped Charles Ferguson with no end in sight.
Yes.
I was the executive producer of that film. But you were starting to talk about Client 9, because in fact...
But Client 9 does it, too. Elliot
Spitzer is a guy who was pugnacious.
Yeah.
And he did go after those guys. Now, ultimately, those guys took him out. But unfortunately, Elliot gave them the ammunition and the gun. They just pulled the trigger. But he was very effective at marshaling a kind of popular rage and also being able to explain very complex economic ideas in simple terms. That was the genius of Clinton's speech the other night, I thought.
And like the I don't know what level he was on, but the former priest who was in Milwaukee, who was a good guy, but then got kicked out for being gay.
Weakland. Kicked out for being gay. I think
kicked out for the 450?
Well, it was the payoff. That was the problem.
It's always the payoff.
It's always the payoff. It's always the cover-up.
But he seemed like a decent, real guy.
He is a decent man. I think he is a decent man. And I think also he's, now that he's lost his power, he understands more about humanity than he did when he was a powerful politician. Mm-hmm. In some ways, I think Elliot Spitzer is also a more interesting human being now that he's had his comeuppance. His career has been destroyed. Sometimes you see things a little bit more clearly when you have an appreciation for humanity that you don't do when you're all powerful.
Of course, he's great in your movie and also in Inside Job, ironically, because he's in that too. But he's really an interesting figure, and it's funny how, like, being the talk show host, see, you really want to hear him talking, not asking other people questions. He has a lot to say about this world.
Yeah, his editorials may be better than his questions. So as a former lawyer, I find his questions can sometimes be pretty good.
Yeah.
I think he's not bad as a TV host, but I'm kind of a wonkish character. You know, I'm not in it for the Oprah stuff.
So when you went into this, as you got into it a little bit, were you putting together the evidence to make the case as much as you were finding new things, or did you have a sense of where it was going and then you had to figure out how to put the pieces together?
I had a sense of where it was going, but you know, inevitably what happens in stories like this is as you dig you find new things.
Yeah.
And you find new people to talk. Weakland was one of those. It was very hard to get Weakland to talk, but he's key in terms of establishing at least an understanding of the dialogue that was going on between Milwaukee and Rome. Because you have to understand, for years and years and years, the Catholic Church has been saying, look, I don't know why you're talking about this issue with the Pope or the Vatican. The bishops are on their own. They're totally independent of the Vatican. Well, we see that's not quite true. And also we discovered some documents in the process, and through testimony also, we discovered some things that we wouldn't have thought of. So.
Well, once you got him to talk, he really talks. He has a lot to say. So was there anything that was outstandingly surprising to you in terms of what you learned along the way?
What was surprising was how vast a conspiracy or how vast a policy this is. When you look at the patterns that they keep appearing anywhere, when we discovered that deaf school in Verona, Italy, an exact duplicate of what had happened in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and that those kids had also been abused by priests. I mean, it's just staggering. You think it's everywhere. And it's exactly the opposite of what the church was telling us. I think the other thing that was really surprising to me was uncovering that video, the full video of those kids going to confront the priests. You know, a tiny excerpt had been shown on TV, but everything else was assumed to have been lost. And we were able to find it. And it is really an extraordinary document of heroes. I mean, that's the great thing about this film that I like and I'm glad to have done. It's a grim subject, sex abuse, but what makes this story engaging, I think, is that in some way it's about four everyday heroes, not heroes like Gandhi or Martin Luther King, but everyday heroes who were just so appalled by what was being done that they were determined to have their voices heard. And even though nobody listened to them for 10, 20, 30 years, they kept pressing until they really did affect some kind of change and larger understanding. It's great.
Well, historically, the documentaries about this subject have been with characters who have a very, very, very hard time ever saying it out loud, ever
And they're victims, and that's appropriate. Look, you know, victim stories are important. Generally speaking, I'm more interested in perps than victims. Mm-hmm. In this case, I became interested in heroes.
Mm-hmm. So the phrase you used before, which now of course my brain is stopping, that this is now actually like a rule of thumb. What's the word I'm looking for? I'm having a hard time. That this has actually become part of the system and not. Is not an extraordinary event that the church, as recorded in the movie, says, you know, makes these excuses for having sex with children as somehow being actually like standard operating procedure, as opposed to.
Well, I think their cover up is the crime. The cover up is the crime. In other words, when the church discovers that priests have been abusing children, instead of warning the victims, instead of reaching out to them. They cover it up.
But when he says, I figure if I just do it once a week, it'll be okay. This is how I'm going to, you know.
Well, that was Murphy's sick rationalization. I mean, I think Murphy had a sickness. I don't think there's any doubt about that. And you can't blame his sickness on the Catholic Church. But what you can blame on the Catholic Church is their unwillingness to act on the danger that the children were in because they were in such close contact with a criminal.
But doesn't that rationalization unfettered become seep out into other rationalizations for other people and almost encourage the acts ultimately?
What do you mean?
The idea that these kind of things, that you have somebody out there who's saying so plainly that he's making a choice.
Oh, his rationalizations are clearly the rationalizations of a sick man, but they do have a kind of metaphorical value because they are ultimately the rationalizations of the church. Because we do so much good,
right?
You know, don't punish us for the few things that we do wrong. Well, then don't hide the things that are wrong. I mean, I think that's what's really burning people up about the sex abuse crisis, is the unwillingness of the church to reckon with the crimes. And the willingness to cover them up. The line that seems to provoke such a hush and almost a gasp in the audience is when, in Ireland, the section in Ireland, when Des Connell, the former Archbishop of Dublin, you know, was asked by some guy, why didn't you go out to the victims and warn them so they could go to the police? And the guy says, oh, I suppose I should have, but I had so much to do. Mm-hmm. What? What did he have to do? You know, decorate the Christmas tree? You know, these kids' lives were in danger, and he didn't do anything.
But see, I even go further myself. I feel like it's almost an encouragement when there is, when these things are met with silence, it almost encourages more people who might be of that proclivity or holding themselves back.
I believe that's true.
To engage in a way.
I believe that's true.
Which is horrifying. Well, I apologize for mixing up your movies again. I feel like I did this 2 years ago, where it's kind of like on this. You and Charles had been competing for the Oscar a year before that, and that I was mixing and matching. But so I do apologize for that.
Not a problem.
The movie is amazing and powerful. Do you feel like when you have this much coming out, when you have this much product coming out, does each one feel as intense when you give it birth?
Some feel a little bit more intense than others, and I would have to say that this is one of the really intense ones. I mean, this, like Taxi to the Dark Side, is quite personal to me, you know, because I was raised Catholic. And Taxi to the Dark Side had a lot in it about my father in the background because he was a naval interrogator. So this was a tough one for me. And also it required entering a world that is not easy to penetrate, the world of the deaf, not to mention the world of the Vatican. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this one was hard.
And when you talked about at the Q&A setting up post-film programs, different kind of things to encourage other people to get involved and to know more about this, yes?
Yeah. I think we have to, you know. So I think, you know, working with HBO and working with our distributors around, we're going to set up a series of websites so that people can be in, can go someplace to find out more.
And is there more information? Is there stuff you couldn't fit in this film?
There's lots. There's lots of information. There's lots of local information for people, and there's lots of vast information about, you know, cases that are being brought, and, you know, there's a tremendous, you know, films like this are agents provocateurs, and they should provoke people to dig deeper themselves.
Thinking outside of your own head is hard these days, I think, in the world of so much information coming at us all the time, but I think there was nobody in that room that I was seeing the movie in a few minutes ago who was not just stunned into silence and amazement through the whole movie. It's very horrifying. I guess that was a statement.
No, that's all right. I mean, it's horrifying, but I find within it a certain amount of hope. You know, that's why we end the film with that moment where the guy goes like this, deaf power, because it was empowering for those guys. They made a difference. Mm-hmm. And that's how the film ends. And then it cuts to silence in deference to the deaf. And so for me, the note, as the film ends with a note of hope, as grim as it has been.